How do digital cameras work? The camera is one of those wondrous inventions that changed the world. Before it arrived, the only way to make a picture was to draw it or paint it, which obviously removed a fair amount of the spontaneity when you were trying to knock off a quick selfie of yourself giving epic duck face while eating a Mackie D's with your bezzy mates. It's probably why Rembrandt always looks so depressed in his self-portraits. Anyway, the camera made it possible to make an instant picture in a fraction of a second, but the process involved in getting the image out of the camera and printed was a complicated one. The light-sensitive film had to be carefully removed, sent to a processor, get developed, turned into a negative, and then printed onto photographic paper in the dark, which was a problem with the rise of the digital age and the internet and your pressing need to upload a picture of Fluffy to the My Cat Looks Like Hitler web forum. But while the microprocessor revolution started to transform many parts of our lives from the 1970s onwards, the digital camera was a relatively late invention, arriving after the video camera, the mobile phone, the laptop computer, and even the Billy Big Bass singing plastic fish. This was because the technology that lies at the heart of it, the sensor chip, is unbelievably complicated. In a film camera, light is sent through a lens and a shutter onto photosensitive film, which, with a subject shot in normal light, needs just hundredths of a second of exposure to capture the image. The front end of a digital camera works on exactly the same principle. Light is focused through the lens and controlled by a shutter and a variable aperture. But instead of film, there's a light-sensitive sensor chip that has to record all of the data in a very short space of time. There are different ways of doing this, but we're going to concentrate on the CMOS, or complementary metal oxide semiconductor sensor, that now sits in the majority of digital cameras, from those integrated in phones to fairly chunky DSLRs. That's digital single lens reflex in the jargon. They're the sort that look like real cameras. The camera sensor is covered with tiny individual light sensitive cells, each of which can measure the amount of light that falls on it. As the digital camera has evolved, so have the number of these pixels on the surface of the sensor. 10 years ago, you'd struggle to get a digital camera capable of delivering much more than a single megapixel of resolution, a million total pixels, or a grid 1,200 by 900. But these days, 12 or even 16 megapixels are commonplace among top-spec prosumer and professional cameras. That's enough to enable you to produce images the size of a magazine cover with no loss in perceived quality. The cells act like the photosensitive chemicals on old-fashioned film, reacting to the light that falls on them and then reporting that to the camera's microprocessor brain. That would be fine for the sort of moody black and white shots favored by gothy Instagram users, but because most of us want to post pictures of our lunch to Facebook in color, it's also necessary to split the light seen by the camera into the three primary colors, which can then be used to create an accurate image. There are different ways of doing this. Some expensive cameras will employ three different filters, but most CMOS sensors will use what's called a Bayer filter. This is a grid of colored filters that sits over the sensor with red, green, and blue elements over individual pixels, and they will only allow their respective light color through. Because the human eye is most sensitive to green light, which largely determines how bright an image looks, there are twice as many green pixels as red or blue ones. The filters are arranged in a clever mathematical pattern, which means that the camera's brain can interpolate using a demosaicing algorithm. Yes, really. Or, slightly plainer language, the camera doesn't just look at an individual pixel on the sensor, it also looks at the pixels around it to come up with an informed guess of what the true color of that pixel is. Although, even the most advanced sensors in the world still struggle with the increasingly unlikely color of Richard Hammond's hair.